electrical engineering major, Adam Saunders has been working under the supervision of Dr. Russell Hardy on deep learning models designed to help better diagnose an all-too-common degenerative eye disease that impacts many people with diabetes. A native of Beaver Creek, Ohio, Adam also plays viola in the University of Dayton Orchestra, and next year will start a PhD program at Vanderbilt University to continue his research on improving medical imaging. Here is Adam.
Oh, watch the curb, Dad. Okay, there's two steps now. All right, the hostess is leading us to the corner booth. Man, this restaurant is so dark, isn't it? Yeah, you should pull out your flashlight. I don't think you'll be able to read the menu in this light. This scene is a typical dinner out with my dad. Now, my dad isn't completely blind, but he's lost a good portion of his vision to diabetic retinopathy and some other complications. Diabetic retinopathy is the leading cause of blindness among American adults, according to the CDC. Through progressive damage to the retina in the back of a person's eye, a diabetic's vision gets worse and worse as time goes on. Virtually all diabetics will be affected by diabetic retinopathy in their lifetime. It can be really serious. My dad no longer drives due to his vision. Early detection of diabetic retinopathy is critical for intervention. I know this not only from personal experience with my dad, but because it's a focus of the research I do. Even with regular access to a doctor, though, diagnosis can still be tedious. Ophthalmologists must spend valuable time looking at fine details from images of the back of a patient's eye, called fundus images. These are just a type of medical image. You might be more familiar with things like MRIs, CT scans, or X-rays. Imagine a tool that could automate the process of diagnosis from an image. These tools are at our disposal with the advent of artificial intelligence, or AI, and deep learning. AI and deep learning can create powerful medical imaging technologies that will create a healthier society that detects diseases earlier and more easily. Deep learning models see the world different than we do, so people like me work on ways to improve the images we give to deep learning models. But let's take a step back. What is deep learning in AI? Very loosely defined, AI is any process where we attempt to give a machine human-like intelligence. Deep learning is a type of AI where we take an input and multiply it by many, many layers of weights to produce some sort of output. Now, this may not sound revolutionary, but the real magic of deep learning is that we can train it to learn by example. If we provide a deep learning model with a set of labeled images containing circles and squares, for example, the deep learning model will learn the difference. You don't need to explain what makes a circle, or why the squares are different from the circles. The deep learning model will learn the differences from the examples alone. Artificial intelligence, AI, and deep learning are changing the world in many ways. For example, autonomous driving has been made possible thanks to AI, which enables self-driving cars to make decisions and react to their environment in real time. DALL-E, a deep learning system developed by OpenAI, has shown the ability to generate realistic and original images from textual descriptions, which could have numerous applications in areas such as advertising and fashion design. ChatGPT, a language model trained on vast amounts of internet text, can generate human-like responses to a wide variety of prompts, making it a useful tool for language processing tasks, such as language translation and content creation. In fact, ChatGPT even wrote this very paragraph. So, where can we use deep learning in medicine? Well, one way we can apply deep learning to medicine is through medical imaging. Deep learning models are particularly well-suited to studying images. There's a digital image on a computer is just an array of numbers, and deep learning models work really well with arrays of numbers. We can use a deep learning model to classify medical images like MRIs or CT scans. We can use a deep learning model to detect cancer from digitized images of tissue biopsies. We can even use deep learning to detect COVID-19 from chest x-rays, something researchers here at the University of Dayton have done. Deep learning and other computer-assisted detection tools would help clinicians immensely. In the medical world, the process of diagnosis is a lot harder than it might seem at first glance. For example, to diagnose lung or kidney cancer from tissue biopsies, pathologists have to spend lots of time looking at tiny cell-level details from a stained slide containing a tissue sample. This process is extremely tedious. Pathologists are completely overwhelmed in hospitals. Another overworked group is radiologists, who have to spend hours flipping between millimeters-thick slices of a CT scan to identify tiny lung nodules to find lung cancer. And, relevant to this project, ophthalmologists who aim to diagnose diabetic retinopathy must do so by looking at tiny details on the fundus images that we talked about earlier. All of these examples have one thing in common. A doctor has to spend a lot of time looking at tiny details on a medical image. And with diagnoses like cancer, time is of the essence. These are diagnoses that could benefit from automation through deep learning. So why aren't we using deep learning to diagnose everything these days? The catch with deep learning is that it needs data, a lot of it. We need tons of examples of images of all kinds in order to train deep learning models with high diagnostic quality. And the problem with obtaining data like this, especially from humans, is that we can never get enough of it. For rare diseases, it can be difficult to obtain just enough data to train a deep learning model. And even when we have enough data, that data can be poor quality, like the fundus image data set I work with. Here, we have a set of fundus images with labels indicating the severity of diabetic retinopathy. 0 indicates no diabetic retinopathy, while 4 indicates proliferative diabetic retinopathy. For comparison, my dad probably lies around a 1 in one eye and a 4 in the other. Do you notice how all the images look different? The lighting is inconsistent. The sizes of the eyes inside the image are different. The aspect ratio of the images are different, too. We have some square images and some rectangular images. And there are some more subtle differences, like how that bright circular spot in each image, the optic disc, it's in a different spot in all of the images. All of these differences mean that this data set is pretty poor quality. Our deep learning models are limited by the data that we have available. If we can improve the quality of our images, we can improve the quality of our deep learning models and get better diagnoses and more accurate diagnoses. So, how can we improve our deep learning models using this data set? Well, first, we can try using pre-processing techniques to make the images look a bit more alike. For example, here's a set of fundus images after we apply some color normalization, flipping, and padding to make the images look a bit more similar. Now, you might be thinking, these images look strange, and they do look really different from the last set of images we looked at. But this pre-processing leads to a more accurate deep learning model, so more accurate diagnoses. Deep learning models see data different than we do, and this pre-processing is one way we can achieve more accurate diagnoses. There are other ways we can try to increase the accuracy of our model, though, like how we can try to increase the resolution content within an image. Training deep learning models is very computationally expensive. There's a lot of number crunching going on when we use deep learning models, and having bigger images means we need more computational power. So a lot of the time, deep learning models use small images as inputs. Around 300 by 300 pixels is common. For comparison, a modern smartphone like the one in your pocket can take images at around 10 times that resolution, at around 3,000 by 4,000 pixels. By using a resolution that is much smaller than what is available, our deep learning models are likely missing out on a lot of valuable information in an image. Deep learning models see the world different than we do, again. So, if we can increase the resolution content in our image, we can maybe get more accurate deep learning models. Our second idea for improving how we use this data set is focusing on a smaller area of the image that might be more relevant to diagnosis. In image processing, we call an area like this a region of interest. If we can crop the area around this region of interest, we can get a smaller image that contains, hopefully, all of the relevant information for diagnosis. After all, a deep learning model doesn't need to worry about the black background of an image or large patches of tissue without any interesting information. Selecting the specific area to be our region of interest, though, is a whole problem on its own. Here, we use a technique called class activation mapping to generate a heat map of the areas most relevant to classification. This heat map is another example of how deep learning models see data different than we do. Do you notice how it focuses on areas of the image that you might not have paid attention to? We select the pixel with the highest value on this heat map and use it as the center of our region of interest. We take the region of interest from our original high-resolution image and use it as the input to a second deep learning model in the hopes of obtaining a higher accuracy. Notice, however, that our region of interest leaves out a lot of the rest of the image. Instead, we might want to try somehow emphasizing that area without cropping everything else out. This brings us to our third idea for how we're improving how we use this data set. Currently, we're studying nonlinear downsampling techniques and image transformations, basically methods that stretch the areas we care about and shrink everything else. The results are images that look very warped and strange to our eyes. However, to a deep learning model, these images might be full of valuable information that they couldn't focus on before. Again, deep learning models see data different than we do, and applying image transformations like this could lead to a more accurate model. Just as we don't need to explain to a deep learning model what makes a circle different from a square, we don't need to explain why these images have diabetic retinopathy or why they don't. We just need to apply transformations that allow the deep learning model to learn that relationship in the best way possible. So, why does this all matter to you? Well, first, understand that there's a revolution going on in medical imaging thanks to AI and deep learning. This project deals with fundus images of the eye, but there are many more medical images out there, like MRIs, CT scans, ultrasounds, PET scans, X-rays, and many more. Second, contribute to medical data sets if you ever get the chance. Adding more data is the easiest way for us to improve our deep learning models. So, if a doctor ever asks your permission to contribute to a medical data set, know that donating a simple image can help create stronger models for understanding our health. We can automate the process of diagnosis from an image using deep learning. Diagnoses that can help detect cancer without waiting on a pathologist. Diagnoses that can help detect dementia more easily from an MRI of the brain. Diagnoses that could help people with diabetic retinopathy, like my dad. I firmly believe that we can leverage the tools of AI and deep learning to create a healthier society. Thank you.